I'm at a place called Westley's Wharf. So this is following on from my other video where I cycled along the old Swindon Canal. Now this time I'm looking for a trackway that will take me up to the old town. Morning. I'm on a quest to find out a little about a local author and a poet by the name of Richard Jefferies. He was born at a place called Coate, which is on the outskirts of Swindon now, and he worked for the local rag, the Evening Advertiser, and he lived for a spell at Coate, where he was born, but he also lived for a little while up in Old Town. So I'm going to try and find the place where he, both places where he was born and where he lived, get some photographs of those, and have a little ride round parts of Swindon which I think are quite nice. Now, if memory serves, I've got a bit of an incline to cycle up, so I might get a bit out of puff. You'll have to forgive me if I sound a bit puffed out. So I'm going up quite a steep hill now. The road zigzags quite sharply. Looks like there's a natural spring running down the road here. At this point, I'm standing on the pedals. I'm not going very fast. I could be in a lower gear, really. I'll select a lower gear in a minute. That's leveling off a little bit. Bit of a short, sharp climb there. Good to get the old heart and lungs working. You're going under a bridge. I'm going to a lower gear. A couple of lower gears. Down here. I shan't cycle down it, but it's Westley Cop Manor. Well, I think I will actually, because Westley Cop Manor is alleged to be haunted. It's now old people's home. And we used to pick up lots of the nursing assistants, etc., that used to work here. And they always used to say they used to hear things which went bump in the night and see things. That's Westley Cop Manor. Worth a photograph, I reckon. Got some nice bluebells out in the sunlight. Very nice to see. And so from Westley Cop Manor, we cycle along Westley Cop Road, Belmont Crescent, Goddard Avenue intersection just here. Very affluent area of town. Some lovely old houses here. Just here, we're going into the old town gardens. Quite pleasant. Look at that. There's the old the gatehouse. A sign saying to maintain social distancing. I'm sure there'd be a few people lingering around here. This is a very popular area of the old town. For reasons that are plain to see. Let's climb up these steps. Bandstand over there. Let's get back on the bike. Riding through the old town gardens. I don't know much of the history of the old town gardens, so I can't really say anything about it apart from it being just a very nice place. There's a squirrel. So that's it, we're now exiting the old town gardens. We'll do a left here. We're heading up now to the old town itself. And the first place I'm going to visit will be actually the place where Richard Jefferies lived for a while whilst he was working for the local newspaper, the Evening Advertiser. So we come up to Bath Road, which hopefully is quite quiet. This would normally be quite a busy part of town. Not many vehicles present on the road now, thank goodness. At the end of Bath Road is a roundabout. And we take a left into Victoria Road, and it's along here where Richard Jefferies used to live. On the right hand side is the Evening Advertiser. I'll just stop here, take a photograph. There's the Advertiser, Gazette and Herald, and the Star. These being the newspapers where Richard Jefferies used to work. I'm just looking for a blue sign, because these are old properties along here. I think it's that one there. That's where Richard Jefferies used to live. Let's take a photograph of that. Now you can't see much from over here, but move closer and I can see it says Richard Jefferies lived here. So that's That's where Richard Jefferies used to live. There. Now we go to his place of birth, which is about 2 miles away. Now I'm up in Winifred Street in the old town on my route to Richard Jefferies' birthplace, and just come across this old block of garages here. This is the sort of thing which won't be around for much longer. I'd have thought they'd be knocking those down soon, so I thought I'd take a photograph to preserve the image for posterity, I think it is. Now I'm heading down now along Marlborough Road. This is the road which would, as its name suggests, take you on to the town of Marlborough. Very prosperous area of Swindon again, with large houses as you can see. And it's at the end of this road where we come to a place known as Coate, which back in the day would have been perhaps just a small hamlet, but it's the birthplace of Richard Jefferies. Now here we are, we're actually at Coate now. Just around the corner here is the old house where Richard Jefferies was born. This is the pub called the Sun at Coate. And then beyond the pub, there's a garden wall. Beyond the garden wall, Richard Jefferies' birthplace. There's a gate, a plaque which tells you about the birthplace of Richard Jefferies. A lovely little blue gate. Hi there. And peeping above the garden wall, we can see the house itself. There's the house. I've got another video on my channel where I visited Richard Jefferies' museum. I tagged it on the end of one of my camping videos sometime last year. Anyway, behind Richard Jefferies' birthplace, we've come to Coate Water Country Park. Now, Coate Water itself, from what I know, has something to do with the canal system. It was a body of water that was used to replenish the canal when necessary, I believe. Quite an extensive body of water. We'll have it all cycle around Coate. No doubt, back in the day, this would have been an area which Richard Jefferies knew very well. And he talks about Liddington. Liddington is over there in the distance. This camera won't show it, but a photograph will. So I'll take a photograph of that for you. It's a local Iron Age hill fort, I believe.
So as we cycle around Coate Water, I'll read this little bit from The Story of My Heart, which Richard Jefferies wrote about his home area. And he talks about how he feels he needs to get out and why he has to go to Liddington, of all places. So The Story of My Heart commences 17 years ago. In the glow of youth, there were times every now and then when I felt the necessity of a strong inspiration of soul thought. My heart was dusty, parched for want of the rain of deep feeling, my mind arid and dry, for there is a dust which settles on the heart as well as that which falls on a ledge. It is injurious to the mind as well as to the body to be always in one place and always surrounded by the same circumstances. A species of thick clothing slowly grows about the mind. The pores are choked, little habits become a part of existence, and by degrees the mind is enclosed in a husk. When this begins to form, I felt eager to escape from it, to throw off the heavy clothing, to drink deeply once more of the fresh foundations of life. An inspiration, a long deep breath of the pure air of thought, could alone give health to the heart. And at this point, I'll put in some drone footage that I shot a few years ago now when I was at Liddington, and we'll read the next paragraph, because it mentions it mentions this place where he used to go to get away from this sense of oppression. There is a hill to which I used to resort at such periods. The labour of walking 3 miles to it, all the while gradually ascending, seemed to clear my blood of the heaviness accumulated at home. On a warm summer day, the slow continued rise required continual effort, which carried away the sense of oppression. The familiar, everyday scene was soon out of sight. I came to other trees, meadows and fields. I began to breathe a new air and to have a fresher aspiration. I restrained my soul till reached the sward of the hill. Psyche, the soul that longed to be loose. I would write psyche always instead of soul to avoid meanings which have become attached to the word soul. But it is awkward to do so. Clumsy indeed are all the words the moment the wooden stage of commonplace life is left. I restrained psyche, my soul, till I reached and put my foot on the grass at the beginning of the green hill itself. Moving up the sweet turf, at every step my heart seemed to obtain a wider horizon of feeling, with every inhalation of rich, pure air, a deeper desire. The very light of the sun was whiter and more brilliant here. By the time I had reached the summit, I had entirely forgotten the petty circumstances and annoyances of existence. I felt myself, myself. There was an entrenchment on the summit, and going down into the foss, I walked round it slowly to recover breath. On the southwestern side, there was a spot where the outer bank had partially slipped, leaving a gap. There was the view over a broad plain, beautiful with wheat and enclosed by a perfect amphitheatre of green hills. Through these hills, there was one narrow groove, or pass, southwards, where the white clouds seemed to close in the horizon. Woods hid the scattered hamlets and farmhouses, so that I was quite alone.
this nearly concludes my circumnavigation of Coatewater Country Park. Down at the end here is a diving board. I've never seen anyone dive off of it, funny enough. I'll stop and get a photograph of that, and then I shall head off home. And there's a diving board and lots of swans. So I hope you have enjoyed that little brief jaunt around the old town of Swindon, and a little look into Richard Jefferies. I'm not the greatest of readers when it comes to reading aloud, although I do think Richard Jefferies had a really fantastic way with words. And he's been forgotten, I think, a lot in recent times, but I think there's been a resurgence in interest in him. So anyway, with that, thanks for watching. If I'm able to continue the bike riding Swindon Diaries, then I've got another couple of places I'd like to show you, maybe in an upcoming video. So until then, thanks for watching. Bye for now.